Some question?
Yes, first question from Pavan Krishna Prabhu.
Yeah.
In Jagannath Puri, in Chatak Pavat, Sarasvati Thakur installed the motifs of Vyasadev and Madhvacharya. What was his idea? Why these motifs in particular?
I haven't heard. I don't know.
Okay. Another question is from our Chinese friend. So,
which Chinese friend?
You don't know.
I know. Okay, one of them.
Yeah. He's saying, "I'm living an ordinary life as everyone else. I don't have any religious belief, and I don't
see any religious
belief."
Belief.
Yeah. And I don't see God show up or intervene in my life. He is so irrelevant. Why should I worship him or know him?
Well, you're making the assumption that you're seeing properly. So if you're seeing properly, then we can understand why one would think that way. But if there's something, if you're willing to consider that maybe you're not seeing everything fully, the full picture, then you may have to reconsider. So without any conception of God, the notion, of course, someone will resist the idea, why should I worship God? Well, then you shouldn't. You have no God concept. What would you be worshiping? But if someone is fortunate, we're told, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyuanji Guru Krishna Prasadipai Bhakti Lata Bij, wandering the length and breadth of the universe, going from one life to another, one life form to another. Fortunate people come in connection with an agent of divinity. So, Srila Sridhar Maharaj, when he was preaching once, someone, and this is, we have to start at the basic position, someone challenged him by saying, if the finite can know the infinite, he's not infinite. Right? It's just an expanded version of finite. Right? One of his sayings also is, the sum total of the finite is never equal to the infinite. So that gentleman's telling him, if the finite can know the infinite, it's not infinite. So this seems to be an argument against understanding God or divinity. But Guru Maharaj's answer was, if the infinite cannot make himself known to the finite, he's not infinite. So you can say, from your perspective, you don't see how any trace of God or divinity in your life. That's from a finite perspective. But Guru Maharaj put forth his proposition, can the infinite make itself known to the finite? Whether or not you can accept that. You're saying the infinite possibility of things, you'd have to accept the possibility that the infinite can make itself known to the finite. And therein lies the basis of theistic culture. So, what is the source of everything, including ourselves? If someone thinks that this just happened, it's some kind of a mistake that just happened, then how can they really have a meaningful life? The theistic pursuit is to trace the original source of everything. If someone thinks that that is just some accidental freak of nature, then they can remain in their position, no problem. But if we think we are conscious beings, the source of consciousness, something unconscious. We think matter produces consciousness, or consciousness manipulates matter. If we think that the latter, that consciousness can manipulate matter, then we can think, we are conscious beings. What is the original source of all consciousness? You say that this is a question from someone in China, then I can mention when I was flying on Air China from Beijing to New York, and sitting next to me was a professor who's Chinese but teaching in America, a professor of advanced computer science. So I thought it was a good opportunity to ask him some questions. I said, coming from Chiang Mai, and they have them in China too, the Lilavati flower, what is it called in Chinese? That's what I was going to say. Same flower, Goloka Champak in India, plumerias in Hawaii, this beautiful fragrance. It's the fragrance is heavenly, the color is beautiful, the touch is so many things. So thinking of them, I asked him, I said, can you say or deny with absolute certainty that the original source of all fragrance, aroma, has no olfactory capacity? Means cannot smell. And his answer was, he said, as you have phrased this question, can I say that or deny with absolute certainty? No. I may not believe that, but I can't say with absolute certainty. I said, then I don't have to ask you any more questions, because I can reframe this question in terms of every one of the senses, with regard to seeing beautiful things, hearing music, beautiful sound, touching something that is soft and gentle, that is pleasing to the touch, tasting something that is wonderful. So you can't deny, he's saying, no, you cannot deny with absolute certainty the possibility that the original source of all of these things does not possess these abilities, including consciousness. And if you add this all together, it's what we call personality. So from even from a rational point of view of being open to infinite possibility, you'd have to accept the possibility of the personality of Godhead. And then, if you could begin this sort of theistic culture that includes understanding that that original source of everything is in control of everything, right? Including the world that we find ourselves in. Like they have a saying, not a blade of grass moves without the will of God. So we notice many events taking place without our will. Humanism is telling us through creative visualization and envisioning yourself winning and being successful, you will be successful. But we see that's not actually true. Many talented people, talented, intelligent, skilled people fail. It's always a possibility because you cannot control the world or those within the world, sometimes or most often, including ourselves. Yet it seems to be under some sort of control. So that control that's in the controller, that's in the background of this world, is friendly to me or antagonistic to me? Is against me or for me? The theistic proposition is that the original supreme controller of everything is friendly to you. Bhoktaram yagyatapasam sarvalokamaheshwaram suhridam sarvabhutanam. This is in Bhagavad-gita. And then the next line says, knowing this, you can find some peace in this world. Gyatva mam shantim vrishtiti. Shanti means peace. Knowing this, that who's the, reality is for itself and by itself. The supreme controller of everything is your dearmost friend. Right? So that is theistic culture. If someone says, this is not meaningful to me, what can you say? We're not here to force someone to believe something that they're just opposed to. That's their choice. The surrealistic painter, Salvador Dali, was asked, and they said, Dali, do you believe in God? And he said, yes, but I have no faith. So that's another position. If someone says intuitively, I believe that there is God, but my conception is not very developed. That's one position. If someone says intuitively, I disbelieve all of these things, then that's your right. Your prerogative to not believe. But then we come back to the basis of spiritual culture once again. As when Guru Maharaj was in the Himalayas, he had a migraine, and two men were arguing back and forth in the room nearby. Someone in favor of the existence of God and the soul, someone against that, said, I doubt the existence of God, I doubt the existence of soul. So Guru Maharaj called that man and said to him, does the doubter exist? Then we have to go to this very basic position. Does the doubter exist? Who's asking this question? They doubt. So does the doubter, who's doubting, do they exist? If you can accept the existence of the doubter, and you must, it's logically, then you understand. There you are something or someone who's capable of doubt on one side and belief on the other side. So we find in the scriptures, Chaitanya Charitamritam, when Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Gopinathacharya, they're discussing the divinity of Mahaprabhu. And Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya saying, I think he's a Siddha Purusha, Mahapurusha, a spiritual personality of the highest level of attainment. He's showing all these ecstatic symptoms. But you say I should accept that he's God and an avatar, and from what I've been able to read in the scriptures, I don't see it. Right. Said one of his names is Triyuga. He only appears in three ages. So they start going back and forth. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, he's quoting some slokas, Gopinathacharya quoting some slokas. So it depends on, as Nietzsche said, there are no facts, only interpretations. It's how you interpret what is before you. An atheistic interpretation, a theistic interpretation, both are open to you. But on this point, Gopinathacharya said, what is the point of arguing this? Atapite deva padambuja dvaya prashadaleshanugrihite evadi. Saying, unless you have a little bit of mercy, you won't get it, you won't understand it. And Sarvabhaumacharya Bhoma Bhattacharya says, oh, what's the evidence that you've got this mercy and I don't? And Gopinath said, that I can understand that Mahaprabhu is Swayam Bhagavan, the original personality of Godhead, and you can't recognize that. So from a rational point of view, someone say, oh, that's a circular argument. It may be, still, it has its merit. Saying, there has to be some mercy involved. This isn't a question of intellectualism or data transfer or information. So you see what is before you, the circumstances that you're in. You can interpret them theistically, agnostically, or atheistically. That is there. That option is there. But as Guru Maharaj told to the doubting man, does the doubter exist? And if you say, yes, of course, then that's Atmagyan 101, the basic of spiritual culture, to understand the soul, whose presence is understood by consciousness, has the capacity to believe or to doubt. Right? And theistic culture is the culture of faith. So a theist can see the friendly hand of the Lord in the background of all events and circumstances in their life. An agnostic doubts that, an atheist doesn't see it. All positions are okay. That's the choice. But if someone can be candid about what their position is in this world, the world of mortality, where you live here for a relatively brief time, and what is that purpose? If you think that we're nothing more than promiscuous chemicals, right? That's what we are. No soul, no God, we're just promiscuous chemicals. Right? In biology, with a biological imperative to reproduce, then what's all the fuss about? The hoax of all of this civilization, if we're no different than animals, the purpose of life is just to reproduce and produce the next generation. But really, the body is like an organic shadow of consciousness, is what it is. Consciousness is the substantial thing. And consciousness will not be satisfied or feel fulfilled by knowledge. The ultimate food of consciousness is anandam, happiness and pleasure. And we're seeking happiness of a permanent type, an eternal type. Krishna is happiness personified. The Vedanta tells us anandamayo byasat, that absolute, who, as we told to the scientists, can see, hear, taste, touch, smell, feel, is the source of all the senses, is a personality who by nature is joyful, full of love, charm, and sweetness. If the prospect of that being true piques one's imagination, then you begin the pursuit of theistic culture. Otherwise, we wish you well.
We are taught to hear from authorized source. Does this hearing...
From an authorized source? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
Does this hearing refer to the sound vibration in particular, or the teaching essence, which can also be realized in reading scriptures?
It means both, because what is reading really but a type of hearing? That's why sometimes we are advised to read aloud, especially when it comes to Sanskrit verses and Bengali and important ones. It's good to vibrate them aloud. Guru Maharaj, who, you know, one of his themes is substance over form, a theme running throughout his teachings. Still, he said when he was younger, he heard this Vedic aphorism, avritir sarva shastranam bodhadapi guriyasi, that it's not as important to understand the meaning as to continually go on hearing. So for Guru Maharaj, that sort of appears to be going against the current of one of his consistent themes, right, which is substance over form. He said, but when he came to Gaudiya Math, he began to understand that more clearly, that by faithfully hearing the scriptures, he has compared it to like ice melting, that what sometimes may appear to be like hard and inaccessible in the beginning, through the service of hearing. After all, Shravanam is part of Nava Bhakti. It's a service to hear. And that gradually, he's saying, the slokas melt into one's heart, actually. So, reading can be a type of hearing as well. But when you say, what did it say in the beginning? Hearing from authoritative sources? Is that what it said? Yes. So, who's an authoritative source? Sanatana Goswami saying, Avaishnavo mukod girnam putam harikatam ritam sravanam naiva kartavyam sarpo chistam yatapayo. Not to hear even, you know, authentic scriptures from someone who is not a Vaishnava proper. Sarpo chistam yatapayo, saying it's like milk poisoned by a cobra. That substance should be a nectarine substance, but the intent of the speaker can contaminate that substance. So he's saying, don't hear these things from them, like the Bhagavatam, Gita, the mantram, everything, not to hear from them. Then it's because of the ulterior motive of that speaker, it's the apparently nectarine substance has been poisoned and turned into something else. As we hear in the case of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, that's a professional Bhagavatam reciter, wanted to add his name to a list. You know, like these are the, that's how they do it, keep a little book. These are the people I've read Bhagavatam for. So he wants to add Babaji Maharaj's name to the list. Babaji Maharaj is trying to avoid this. Somehow it's forced upon him. So Babaji Maharaj is there with a group of people, and this man gives a Bhagavatam recitation. And after he leaves, Gaur Kishoredas Babaji Maharaj tells the remaining people, get some cow dung and some cow urine and cleanse this place. Right? That's the Vedic way to remove contamination. And they're thinking, but we've heard that, you know, the Bhagavatam, that's, you know, what does it say? Krishna sva dhammo bhagati dharma jnana dibhiksaha kalo nashtra dushamesha puranarko duno dataha. After Krishna's left the world and the world is plunged into the darkness of ignorance of Kali Yuga, that the Bhagavatam has risen like a brilliant sun, and these 18,000 rays, you know, of slokas giving illumination. And that Bhagavatam, so it is purifying, the speaker is purifying, the inquirer is purified, the very place, the audience listening is purified, the place in which the transaction takes place is purified. And we just heard the Bhagavat recitation, and now Babaji Maharaj is telling us, get cow dung and cow urine and cleanse this place. And they're thinking, but we just heard the Bhagavatam. He says, you heard Bhagavatam. He said, all I heard was money, money, money. So what is he telling us? If we had a recording, we'd say, no, in fact, he was quoting slokas. No, Babaji Maharaj is making a point. His motive is he's using the Bhagavatam for his livelihood. So it's contaminated the dissemination process. To take spiritual knowledge use that to make a living is to pollute the very substance. So he's polluted, the audience is polluted, the place is polluted. So what is an authoritative source? Srila Prabhupada, he called his Bhagavad-gita, interestingly, Bhagavad-gita as it is. And he used to say, and we've heard from others, there's hundreds of editions of Bhagavad-gita. Right? It's one of the reasons he gave it the name, Bhagavad-gita, as it is. Why? Saying because there are those who are taking Bhagavad-gita and they're polluting it with their own misconception. Fame, Krishna, Bhagavad-gita, famous, and then take it in another direction. So I remember traveling and presenting Prabhupada's books to university professors, and I was wondering about that, how many editions. And I was at a school, I think it was NYU, where they had a library of several million volumes of books. And this is before the internet, so there's the card catalog. So I pulled out the drawer and I started looking, like counting, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I got it with around 70 or 80, and so I was only like halfway through, and I thought, wow, at this library, they've got 150 Bhagavad-gitas. So Prabhupada was right. He said hundreds of editions. But then it occurred to me, and you could look in different ones and see, and you'd see, in every one of them, for example, Krishna says, you know, manmana baba madbhakto majjajimam namaskuru yam evoshasi yuktvayam atmanam parayana jai srila bhakti vimalavadut maharaj ki jai. And all these Bhagavad Gitas, it says, become my devotee, give up everything and surrender to me. They all have this, these slokas there. And it occurred to me, and for hundreds of years, right? At least, you know, 100 years or so. And reading that, no one decided to do that. That's also interesting. It says it in every single edition, but no one decided to do that. then Prabhupada makes this, the same book that everyone's been translating left and right for 100 years, he makes this book called Bhagavad-gita as it is, with his claim that he's presenting this purely. And suddenly, there's this movement called the Krishna Consciousness Movement that is established, and hundreds and thousands of people, when they read, "Become my devotee and surrender to me," do that. This is just a fact, right? This isn't, from a prejudicial point of view. There are all these other books, they have the line in there, becoming, and no one decides to do that. They go, "Oh, the book's very interesting. I find it's fascinating, and it's fascinating, it's interesting, it's mystical, it's all these wonderful things. It's cool, it's hip, right? It's everything." Right? But no one decides to become a devotee. They read this other book, has the same line there, saying, and they decide, in addition to all those other things, I want to become a devotee of Krishna. So then we can understand what the real meaning of an authoritative source is. There's some potency there. Like the Padma Purana says, "Sampradaya bihinaye mantraste nishpalamata." You think, Maha Mantra, you can get it in a gift shop. You can get it at Amazon.com, right? Complete with your beads, incense, and poster. Right? And if you're, Amazon Prime, maybe you'll get your mala free. Right? But it's saying, if the mantra you receive doesn't come from a generally potent source, nishpal means no fruit. It won't produce any fruit. It may amuse you. It may do so many things for you, but the fruit that is to be gotten from this, you won't get. So, Prabhupada, he used to be very upset with the Dr. Radha Krishnan edition of Bhagavad Gita. He was the first president of India. Right? When Gandhi was the prime minister, he was like the first president. And he was a scholar, and Dr. Radha Krishnan. Look at his name, even Dr. Radha Krishnan. And I heard something Prabhupada said about him and his book, and I was at the Calcutta Book Fair, and I saw next to our stall, there was the Bhagavad Gita of Dr. Radha Krishnan. I thought, I've just got to see this one thing to see if it's just, if these are really the words that he said. And in there, it's where, in that section where I just quoted, manmana bhava bhakto, always think of me, become my devotee, sarvadharmam parichajamamekam, give up everything, surrender to me. And I look to see, what does he say in the purport to that? And the first thing he says, it is not to the person, Krishna, to whom we are to surrender ourselves to utterly, but the unborn, impersonal, who's speaking through Krishna. Then I could understand why Prabhupada was so upset. Prabhupada would say, he would be apoplectic, saying he says mom. How many times he's saying mom, and what does it mean? Me. Sarvadhar mam puri chaja mam ekam, me alone, mam ekam. He said, it is not to the person, Krishna, that we are to surrender ourselves to utterly, but the unborn, impersonal, who's speaking through Krishna. One Indian gentleman who was rather fond of Sanskrit was visiting the temple once, and I don't know Sanskrit, but I know some words, some vocabulary. And we're talking about the word lotus, because there's so many words for lotus, like Padma and Kamala, Ambujaksha, Ambuja, not Jaksha, Ambuja means born from the water, Ambuja, and Pankaja, from the mud, born, and Nalina, and there's so many. Kunti Devi is a beautiful sloka. Namak Pankaja. Remember the word Pankaja means lotus. She says, Namak Pankaja Netraya, Namak Pankaja Jangrahe, Namak Pankaja Netraya, Namaste Pankajangrahe. No, Namak Pankaja Nabhaya means the navel. Namak Pankaja Jangrahe, Namak Pankaja Netraya, Namaste Pankajangrahe. Yeah, no, Namak Pankaja Nabhaya, Namak. I missed something. But anyway, when she's praising Krishna, I worship your lotus navel, your lotus eyes, and at last your lotus feet. So anyway, we're talking and supplying words that mean lotus. And he's so excited. Yeah, so many words are there to be very precise about the meaning in a particular context. And for some reason, this came to my mind. I said, yeah, so when Krishna says, you know, Sarvadharma, Mam, Parichaja, Mam, Ekam, Sharanam, you know, he's saying Mam, which is one of the most simple words. It means me, to me. So it means, you know, and the man said, oh, I don't know so many words. One word, Mam, me. He goes, oh, I don't know so many things. So what is Krishna's name? Avajananti Mam, there's the word Mam again. Avajananti Mam Mudha, Manushim Tanamasritam, Paramba Namam Duskritino Mudha, Prapadyante Naradama. Those who are envious, they cannot surrender to me. I mean, Krishna's language is strong. Mudha, Prabhupada liked these verses a lot, it means ass. Avajananti Mamudha, who think I'm a mundane person, a finite being. So Prabhupada would say just very simply, because it says Bhaktosi me sakacheti, on the basis of what's given in Bhagavad Gita, the Gita Rahasya. The secret of Bhagavad-gita is said to be revealed to someone who is what? Friendly to Krishna. He says, Bhaktosi me sakacheti, because you are my devotee and my friend, therefore I reveal this to you. Not because you're a big pundit, you're smart, you're on the advanced program. You know, then that would limit this to some sort of intellectual pursuit. If there were certain academic requirements or mental or intellectual requirements. But Brahma himself with his four heads is saying, Gyane prayasa mudapasana manta eva. Stop trying to measure him. Stop trying to measure the infinite by finite means. He's saying, don't do what I did. I'm saying this child Krishna, who appears to be a child, a five-year-old boy, herding cows in the forest. I have some familiarity with Narayan, right? Brahma is what we call, you know, Atma Yoni, self-born Brahma. What, from Garbhadakshaya Vishnu? There's a navel lake in his Vishnu, because he's big. And then the stem of a lotus flower comes out, and then atop the lotus opens. And then there's Brahma. We take like with one head, but he's like searching. The try and find out the source. Searching so fast, four heads. And then think tapa. I should do some penance. And look, crawls down the stem, looking for the source. Talking about original source. You know. Goes back up to the top of the lotus flower. Tapa. do some penances and austerities without Brahma. Saying, so I have some familiarity with Narayan, who I met later, with his forearms and Lakshmi Narayan, I can understand Vaikuntha, but this boy who's got, what does it say? No me jate, abra vapuse, taridambaraya, gunjava tanksa paripichala sanmukaya. Kavalavetra Vishana Venu, Lakshma Shriye Mridupude Pashupanga Jaya. That was one word. Brahma is now saying about that little boy he saw with the stick in his way and the bamboo flute, picnicking with his friends on the bank of the Jumna, laughing, joking, teasing one another, stealing lunch, doing all the things that boys do, having a good old time on the banks of the Jamuna, saying, Yajna Bhug, the Lord's supposed to be Yajna Bhug. They do these big sacrifices, chant all the mantras, the pundits come out, and at the end, the Lord is offered everything, he takes that, and we take the remnants of sacrifice to believe that that person is sitting on the banks of the Jamuna. He's got food in his left hand, which is not Vedic. Right? The source of the Vedas has food in his left hand. He's eating like that. Cow herding stick in his waist, flute on the other side, laughing, joking. And so he's very difficult to see. Like that person said, they can't see. They're right. Abra Vapu, because his complexion, we're told, is blackish, Ganesham, like a monsoon rain cloud. He's very difficult to see. Taridambaraya. Therefore, when he's dressed, wearing his lightning yellow dress, the contrast makes him easy to see. So Srila Guru Maharaj gives his interpretation. That lightning dress means, and also in a figurative sense, when he's dressed in his shakti, his potency, means Radharani, Hladini Shakti. The Hladini Shakti contrast reveals Krishna. So Brahma is saying, this isn't a conclusion that you reach through intellectualism. Gyane prayasa mudapasana mandeva. Give up the knowing tendency and get ready to bow your head to that plane. Understanding the least aspect of that plane is higher than the highest aspect of myself, beyond the reach of my intellect. Atak Shri Krishna namari nabye bhavye griyam indriye. Rupa Goswami saying, the name, form, qualities, pastimes of Krishna are beyond the grasp of the senses, mind, and intellect. Then we are hopeless, helpless to know the finite cannot know the infinite, but the infinite can make himself known to the finite. How is he likely to do that? Sevan mukhe hijavaru shayam eva spuratida. When approached in the mood of service, not scrutiny, or like the lawyer in the courtroom interrogating the witness. That's what Brahma is saying, not through interrogation. He reveals himself. Gopinatha Charja to Sarvabhoma, Prashada Leshanugrihitevahi. You have to get a little mercy. This can't be avoided. Well, I don't want to deal with all that. The mercy and the surrender stuff. Right. When Guru Maharaj's teacher, who was like in the Shat Darshan of India, is like six philosophical black belts, the different six philosophical systems. He's mastered all of them. And Guru Maharaj is 23, that man's around 70, 80. And Guru Maharaj innocently said to him, he's thinking, oh, a man of your learning, why don't you use your vast intellect and knowledge and experience and, you know, directed toward Mahaprabhu? As Prabodhananda Saraswati Thakur says, na chaitanya chandamritam, dante nidaya trinakam pariyor napatya, kritba chakaku ahangitad satam brinimi, hey sadhava sakala eva vihaya durad, chaitanya chandra charane kurutana ragan. Say, my dear sir, you're so learned, you're fame is so well known, you're so generous and kind and merciful. I have but one request from you, and certainly you'll grant this one simple request of mine. And what is that? He's saying, forget everything you know or think you know, and kindly turn your attention to the lotus feet of Gauranga Mahaprabhu. That's the way Prabodhananda says it. But at the time, Guru Maharaj was just being sweet and naive and suggesting to him, use your vast learning to understand Mahaprabhu. And he said, that man turned and said, oh, my boy, it is not a question of learning. He said, you have to have some mercy. And this is the point why the atheists cannot open their heart, because it requires some candid assessment of oneself as being limited in capacity and prospect, and hopeless and helpless. Then the heart can open, be open towards surrender, find some necessity. That's why Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that the Mayavadis who've locked themselves, he said, in the tomb of samadhi, or Guru Maharaj called it once a concentration camp, that they're cut off from the possibility of mercy. Whereas just an out-and-out sense enjoyer can connect with a devotee and undergo, can transition from being a materialist to a practitioner. Any other question?
We got a question from Kunti Priya Didi.
Hare Krishna.
How is it possible to transform your background sense experience to transcendental aparikrita senses nature? From sound japa to sabda.
From what?
Sound japa.
Sound?
Yeah, the sound.
Oh.
Sound japa to silent bhajan.
The meaning is how the sound, which is mundane, can transcend the spiritual realm. Mm-hmm. Which means, like you say, where Krishna using your physical tongue, how that physical sound can be a spiritual sound.
Is that the full question? Mm-hmm. And what was the beginning part?
How is it possible to transform your background sense experience to transcendental aparikrita senses nature?
Well, two things. It's not that we transform that, but of our experience so far, it helps us understand what it is we seek. Because to try and impose our experience upon the higher, that's known as karma kanda, and that's not the interest of the devotees. But rather, what is genuinely spiritual is what is descending from that plane into this plane. When it comes to divine sound, the holy name, Guru Maharaj says, Vaikuntha Nama Grahanam, means, does it have some spiritual quality to it? If it's spiritual, it means it's descending. If we're taking from our experience here and imposing that on the higher, that's karma kanda. That's not devotion. So we won't be in touch with genuine spiritual substance. But on the basis of our experience here, we can perceive and project what are our tendencies. So, as I mentioned with regard to the word aesthetic, that what's come to mean the search for beauty or the culture of beauty, originally the basis of the word is sense perception. So if we hold these two concepts at the same time, we'll understand it's the culture of the sense perception of seeing beauty, hearing beauty, tasting beauty, sound beauty, form beauty, touch beauty, right? All of those things. So the first book we made for Guru Maharaj, he gave the title, Search for Sri Krishna, Reality of the Beautiful. So the culture of beauty, the search for beauty, for aesthetic experience, culminates in the search for Sri Krishna, Reality of the Beautiful, who is the personification of the form of beauty, the sound beauty of the holy name and the flute, touch beauty, aroma beauty, all of these things. So we don't want to take from this experience here and impose that upon Krishna. Rather, we can understand that as an indication of what we're searching for, but what we're searching for descends from that higher plane. So in different places, it's described in words or descriptions that could be interpreted as meaning, as being formless, right? Impersonal, but not so. So it says, Apani Pado Javanagrihita, he has no legs, no arms, no eyes, no ears. It means no fleshy eye, fleshy arm, fleshy leg, fleshy ear. Yet he hears, sees, tastes, touches, smells, feels. That means he has a divine form. And the Aprakrita Leela of Krishna tells us that that form is the template for human civilization. Krishnara Dateka Kela Sarvatam Nara Leela. Naravapu, Tahara Swarup, Gopavesh, Venukar, Navakishor, Natabar, Naralilohoy Anurupa. As Brahma, when he saw Krishna, he's saying, four-armed Narayan, that looks like God. Right? The majesty of Vaikuntha, Lakshmi Narayan, four arms, saying, very divine looking. Krishna, a Prakriti Lila, human-like, right? Not a scepter, some, you know, Chintamani jeweled scepter, but like a stick in his ways for tapping cows to go to the left, to the right, to do this, to do that. Bamboo flute, garland of forest flowers, suppressed opulence. This is a more refined consideration. Right? Guru Maharaj quotes a Bengali poet saying, human is beyond God. What? It sounds like a ringing endorsement for humanism. The human being is beyond God. But Guru Maharaj explained, what it means is the human-like representation of divinity is superior to the majestic God-like aspect of divinity. That's what it means to say that the human is higher, not to think that we are higher than God, we're superior. But rather, the human-like pastimes. How so? When Srivast Thakur teased the Siddhanta out of Srup Damodar in the Harapanchami festival, Jagannath Puri, when Lakshmi Devi has become suspicious of Jagannath, of Dwarka Krishna, who said he wants to visit his hometown, and she's saying, and girlfriend? And he said, no, my brother and sister are coming with me. Nothing wrong. So he said, all right. So you're just visiting your hometown for a while with your brother and sister? Yes. Going, and after a while she's thinking, I wonder. And Lakshmi Devi is now thinking she's been, cheated. So what does she do? She, not as a woman scorned or neglected, shows up in clothing indicating that position. Rather, she dresses herself super opulently and enters a jeweled throne with so many carriers and servants and a band and singers and dancers, and they go to retrieve Jagannath, Dwarka Krishna. And we're told when they get to the gate demanding Jagannath present himself, they're abusing all the servitors of Jagannath, calling them names, binding them, handcuffing them. They're treating them very with great abuse. And this festival, Harapanchami, Mahaprabhu and his devotees are watching, they're like, they're delighted to see these things. And at that point, Srivast Thakur says, just see the opulence of the goddess of fortune, the unparalleled opulence of Vaikuntha. What do they have in Vrindavan? Trees, flowers, milk sweets. What do they have? River, trees, cows, flowers. And look at Lakshmi Devi, unparalleled, so many gems. And Mahaprabhu tells Srivast Thakur, he asked that question of Srup Damodar. He said, don't disturb Srup Damodar. He said, opulence is not a word in his dictionary. He's a Shuddha Brijbasi, exclusive Vrindavan devotee of Krishna. And Srup Damodar said, no, it's not that I don't understand opulence. He's saying, but Srivast, I think you've lost your mind, some temporary insanity that makes you say these things. You say, what is the opulence of Vrindavan? Just some trees, flowers, milk, the cows, these gopi girls, saying, but those trees are kalpa vriksha, the wish-fulfilling tree. The cows are kamadenu, they fulfill all desires. And the soil of Vrindavan is made of chintamani. We in Brahma sang, chintamani prakara sadmasu kalpa vriksha lakshavrateshu surabhi abhi palyantam. Similar. Lakshmi sahasrasatasam brahma sevyamanam govindam adi purusham tamaham bhajami. That one chintamani gem. Saying, one chintamani gem has in it more opulence than the sum total of Vaikuntha world. How is that possible? That as you take sugarcane juice concentrated condensate, it becomes molasses. Concentrated condensate, it becomes gur, that like taffy-like substance. Concentrated condensate, sugar, and its ultimate concentration, like rock candy. Looks like a diamond, rock candy. And one drop of rock candy is so much sweetness has been concentrated there. So he's saying, in the one Chintamani gem of the soil of Vrindavan has more opulence than the whole Vaikuntha world. And then what? Chintamani Charanabhushana Manganam. And the Braja Gopis, they're stringing those Chintamani gems and wearing them as anklets on their holy lotus feet. He's saying, so what is opulence? What is the, it is the suppressed opulence of the human-like pastimes of Krishna that are supreme. So we, Guru Maharaj says, Kaivalya, on the interpretation of Saraswati Thakur, the real meaning, which seems to mean oneness, he said, means in the sense of don't mix anything in there. What's coming down to us, we need to receive that without mixing anything if we want to draw the maximum benefit. So whatever we've gathered here is only a reference. We don't want to mix that in to what's descending from that plane. If I understand this question properly. Don't put value in limited experience of the limited. We're very proud of that, our limited experience of the limited. At best, it's, you know, a finite perspective. The prospect, the proposition of Krishna consciousness is the transition from a finite perspective to infinite perspective. How exciting, thrilling is that prospect or possibility? You can go from a finite perspective, no matter how vast it is, it's still finite, to infinite perspective. And to do so, what does Krishna tell Arjuna? Dibya chakshu, I give you divine eyes so that you'll have infinite perspective. Chakshu numilitam jena tasmai shri gurave namaha. The disciples getting from guru infinite perspective. Gyaninas tattva darshina. Same thing, consistently throughout. Tadvidya pranipatena. Guru Maharaj said, Saraswati Thakur means to bid adieu to this world and all the things of this world. They will only hamper us. That doesn't mean that if someone's acquired some skill, not to use that in the service of Krishna. Anashaktashyavishyanyatahum upayunjitaha nirbandha Krishna sambandhi yukta vairagyam uchite. Rupa Goswami is saying, to renounce something mundane that could be used in the service of Krishna is falgu vairagya, false renunciation. The true use of everything, including ourselves and whatever acquired skills we have, is in the service of Hari Guru and Vaishnava. But seva comes down from the upper world, descends into this plane. So we're careful to be connected to that. Hare Krishna.